is our first online for the, this migration seminar. This is a joint initiative of different institutions, mostly the University of Luxembourg and LISER in Luxembourg, the Paris School of Economics, the CERDI, the University of Auvergne, and Carlos III Madrid. We decided to merge forces to have this migration seminar taking place on online, remotely, and on a weekly basis. So we're very glad that our first speaker is Martin Ravallion. Martin is a very well-known development economist. He's been for a long time at the World Bank, culminating in 6 years as a head of research until 2013. And since then, he is a professor, the Edmond D. Villani Professor at the Economics Department of Georgetown University. His work is very prominent in different areas of development economics. Mostly is well known for his work on poverty, but also on some international economics dimensions. And he has occasionally contributions to migration, as will be the case today. So today, Martin is presenting a paper called A Market for Work Permits. This is an idea which has been around for quite some time, but is revisiting this idea in a very original way. And this is joint work with his co-author, Mikhail Lokshin, from the World Bank. So Martin, the floor is yours for about 45 minutes, and then we will have 15 minutes questions at the end. Simone Bertoli will serve as moderator, meaning mostly that he will allocate the right to speak to the different participants. And so I will mute my microphone now, and we'll intervene only if I have a clarification question. And I also will give you some indications about timekeeping.
Very good.
Martin, we are listening to
okay.
you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me for this seminar, and thank you all for participating. This is joint work with Michael Lokshin at the World Bank. I think we got very excited about the idea of this paper, and it's all been a bit eclipsed by the age of the virus. But I'm also suspecting there may be some people sitting at home who are starting to realize that there are other things to do besides working for a wage. The problem is, how do you finance it? And that's an overlap with this talk. Okay, the market for work permits. And here are some work permits to a bit of entertainment. I guess since we're all stir crazy at home, you need a bit of entertainment. So I've thrown in a few pictures. But it's a serious paper on the economics of this problem. How do we develop, how do we identify this missing market, and how do we come up with policies? I'll explain that missing market idea in a little while that can deal with it. I'm going to start with this quote from Michael Clements, who's prominent researcher here in Washington, Center for Global Development, trillion-dollar bills on the sidewalk. And what is Michael referring to? Large efficiency losses from restrictions on migration. And we know about the efficiency losses from trade. The really striking thing is that, you know, they may be a few percent of world GDP, but the restrictions on labor mobility, barriers on the economic mobility of labor, could be somewhere around 50 to 150% of world GDP. We're talking about losses, for example, restrictions on migration for relatively low-skilled male workers to the US, around $20,000 per worker per year globally. These are huge numbers. Once you realize this, you kind of think a lot of what we do is really second fiddle and not that important relative to this problem. Lant Pritchett made this point very strongly, that a lot of what we do in development projects is really small scale. I mean, the best, he compares the best we do in the household income gains from development projects, the sorts of things the World Bank does, and development agencies do in developing countries and NGOs. You know, the best we could do is a pittance compared to the lower bound estimates that we have of the costs of restrictions on migration. And this picture graph just tells that story. You can see here the huge differences for different countries, the huge differences in the between what we get from projects and what we could get, I emphasize could get, from removing restrictions on migration. But that's not going to happen very easily. One issue, of course, is behind these numbers, do we have a serious selection bias? That's a question some economists would certainly be worried about. The work that's been done in this literature is pretty convincing on dealing with selection on observables. There's always this problem of selection on unobservables. You're picking migrants that are self-selecting on the basis of some unobserved characteristics. One of the best papers we have on this is by Mushfiq Mubarak and colleagues, where they studied the Bangladesh lottery. This is a lottery in Bangladesh to get a work permit to work in Malaysia. Malaysia is a much higher average income than Bangladesh. So these work permits were potentially very attractive. And what Mubarak and co did is follow up after 5 years. The paper's only just come out. Follow up after 5 years to see what happened to their earnings and the incomes of their families using the randomized assignment of the lotteries as the instrumental variable for migration to deal with the selection bias. And the results are quite striking. Migrant income gains of doubling income over this five-year period, very substantial gains. Also a large reduction in migration costs relative to the private sector. This is something I'm going to come back to. There's a huge, partially illegal, a lot of it illegal, migration industry out there trying to get people into richer labor markets, into high-wage labor markets, but with huge costs. That industry, different estimates, but one I saw from Malaysia, from Nepal, the cost of getting illegal entry is about 10 times the out-of-pocket expenses for airport, FM, passport, and so on, medical checkups, administrative fees. Of course, these workers can't get through the formal channel, and they go through the illegal channel and pay a large sum of money. And also a lot of concerns in the literature about infringements on workers' rights, all kinds of abuses, lack of redress amongst these undocumented workers in the recipient country. They're prevented from unionizing, they're bypassing health and safety standards, with also involving externalities for citizens, and lots of reports on harassment, sexual abuse, trafficking, whipping and caning even. In all of this, women are especially vulnerable. We've got a lot of issues around this topic. Different estimates here on how much the impact would be in the aggregate on destination economies from migration. If anything, the aggregate impacts are probably positive. This is a very uncertain estimate, but economic and cultural benefits to the host country are clear. But that rather misses the point, just as exactly the same in discussions of international trade. We've really got to look at those horizontal impacts as well, the winners and losers at different levels of living. Also issues of social comparisons that arise, tunnel effects. And underlying all of this, a lot of xenophobia, racism that's in the mix. It's a complex problem. So those dollar bills on the beach, on the sidewalk may be stuck there with some strong glue. Getting them off that sidewalk could be a real challenge. And we see a lot of opposition. We've just collected some examples here. These are all opponents to migration. Reducing restrictions on migration. These are people who perceive this as a big threat to their living standard. Maybe exaggerated, maybe not. And again, it's horizontal. There are gainers as well as losers. That's important. But we do see this backlash, and it's not going away. If anything, the age of the virus is going to make it even worse, I suspect. This cultural backlash we're seeing against migrants and refugees. A lot of what I'm going to say today also applies to refugees, and I'll come back at the end to explain that a bit better. So that's our problem. We've got a serious political economy problem with restricted entry, and you're not going to solve this problem unless you share the benefits, the huge benefits I explained to you from the removing restrictions on migration. You're not going to deal with the political economy problem unless you find a way of sharing those benefits between the various parties, and that's a basic principle of dealing with most political economy problems. And how are we going to do that? That's the challenge we're facing today. Okay, let's think about it this way. this question: how can we better manage migration and make migrants more popular in host countries? And that making migrants more popular is a really important part of this. I'm going to argue we need an approach that does three things. It has to be universal, meaning it's accessible and potentially beneficial to all. People see, broadly see, it's got a broad base of support. It's got to be self-targeted. Although it may have a broad base of support, ideally we want to reach those in greatest need. And we have limited information of who they are. I'm talking specifically now about within the host country, trying to assure that this is more popular in the host country. If we're going to tap into those huge efficiency losses from restrictions on migration, we're going to try to do so in a socially beneficial way, the same ethical and economic principle we apply elsewhere in policymaking. And it should be affordable, preferably even self-financing. So that's a tall order. How can we do it? That was the question Misha and I posed, and this is our answer. I'm going to explain it and develop a paper along the following these seven points. First, I'm going to describe this missing market. I think it's probably obvious already, but just a little bit of clarity on that. Then what we propose for creating the market and work permits, which is a two-sided market, not a one-sided market, creating that market. I'm going to outline the proposal in theory, just in slightly formal terms to make sure, make it exceptionally, hopefully, very clear on what the idea is. I'm going to talk a bit about how you do it in practice, some of the issues of designing the appropriate website to implement this auction that we're going to need. I'm going to walk through an example we've developed for the US and Mexico, where we haven't actually, of course, haven't implemented this thing. We're simulating it on large data sets to try to figure out what this market might look like, under various assumptions about the unknown parameters, but trying to nail down the observables as best we can. And then I'm going to talk a bit about how to adapt this policy to differing problems, issues of manpower policy in recipient countries, issues of dealing with refugees and undocumented migrants as well. What is this missing market? Well, the essential idea is that recognition, and this is the key contribution of the paper, I think, that the recognition that citizenship comes with a right to take up a job. If you're a citizen of a country, you have what we call the citizenship work permit. We never talk about it, but it's really important. In fact, for poor people in places like America, it's their main asset. The main asset of poor middle-income people in the United States and in many rich countries, I would expect, is not monetized. They have a citizenship work permit, but they can't cash it in. They can't use it to do anything, really, except get a job, take up a job if it's offered to them. Of course, the citizenship work permit doesn't guarantee you a job. All it says is that you can take a job if one's offered to you. You can accept it. And we also here realize that some citizens in host countries would be very happy to do something else and work for a wage, at least for some period. So that's one side of this missing market. And that's the side that I think has been ignored. The other side is more familiar. We have many foreigners who want jobs in these countries. And a foreigner needs a work permit to take up employment in the host country. And in a nutshell, the idea of this paper is to create a situation where everybody needs a work permit. Citizens need a work permit, foreigners need a work permit, and we have a market in that thing. Now, there are some past proposals. A number of them are going back to work of Barry Chiswick, Gary Becker and Lazier, proposing that countries sell citizenships or work permits, but they were focusing on really essentially passports. And some of that has actually happened, cash for passport schemes or golden visa programs and so on. There have also been proposals for using visas, Emmanuel Oriol and Alice Minard, using them to control smuggling. I'll come back to the interaction between creation of a market and illegal migration in the talk. Also proposals for visa auctions, selling work permits to compensate for vulnerable native workers, a nice paper by Weinstein some years back. A host of proposals. We argue that none of these proposals are really efficient solutions to the underlying market failure. Once you realize there's a market failure, you also realize soon after, I think, that there is a quite efficient solution to this if we can find a way of implementing it politically. It would have very low transaction costs, much lower than these past proposals. But also there will be costs and benefits. It's not a unambiguous gain. There'll be changes in the distribution of income within recipient countries, within the host countries, that are quite important. Also, which are quite attractive, in changes in distribution, reductions in inequality, reductions in poverty, and so on. So how would we get there? Basic idea is that citizens would be free to rent out their work permit for a period of their choice. The idea would be that the market equates demand and supply for these work permits. There's an aggregate supply coming from the host countries. There's an aggregate demand coming from low-wage economies or lower-wage economies. We create a market when the equilibrium price balances aggregate supply and aggregate demand. As I'm going to explain later, you don't have to have that feature if you want to have if you're in a transition period in a country like Malaysia, for example, which is going to need a large intake of migrants going forward. Then you can juggle the design of the thing to accommodate that. A key thing is the market is anonymous. It's disembodied from the person's renting out their right to work. It's not like you have to find somebody to take your job. That's not necessary at all. This market is fully anonymous. The people selling their work permit do not need to ever know who buys a work permit. They also, the balance in terms of aggregate supply and aggregate demand can be done in time units. It's not like people have to balance. Obviously, people selling their work permits may be selling for a shorter period than people buying their work permit. You're not going to buy a work permit to come to work here for a day. Probably a year minimum would be reasonable, whereas some people would be selling work permits for maybe just a month to bridge a problem they have in financing or they've lost their job or whatever. The various advantages we can see of a competitive market for work permits, we think it would be broad appeal. As I said, there'll be some losers, but there'll be a lot of gainers. Low transaction costs would be as I become more to implement this thing. And obviously the scope for social protection is important. This is when I say social protection here, I'm talking about insurance as well as poverty relief. And the insurance policy here, this would actually be a remarkably good insurance policy. Anybody who had a shock could deal with that shock very effectively in the host country, any citizen who faces a shock can sell their work permit for a period to deal with the shock. Who might want to do that? We can think of many examples. A young person financing extra schooling all over the world. Kids from poorer families get less schooling. They leave school earlier. They can't afford to stay at school. Well, here's an option for them. You may want to restrict that option a bit. You may want to insist that they spend a bit of time in the labor market for various reasons, but I'll come back to that if necessary. But also other possibilities. A lot of concern now about home care for the elderly. This is one way of financing it. We know that home care is much more effective than institutional care. So if you need to look after your grandmother for a period, you can't afford to do that because you need your job. Well, here's a way of financing it. We're dealing with unemployment. You have an unemployment shock, or you need to move to a more attractive labor market, or you need to finance some new skill because the main employer has left your town and that was the only skill you had. Setting up a new business, working in a different country, even taking a long vacation, retiring early, or dealing with serious illness. We give a couple of examples here. These are examples we know of. Michelle Ramirez, a single mother of two, struggling to make ends meet in the receptionist salary, a daycare, medical costs rising. That balancing of work-life is a problem for a lot of people. And again, elderly home care, just one example. Same basic idea. The legal interpretation of all of this needs some thought. We give it a rights interpretation. We've had a pushback from some people saying, well, this is a citizenship right. You can't sell it. Well, in a sense, we're not saying you sell the ownership right for your work permit. All you're selling is the use right. The ownership right stays with you. You remain, as a citizen of any country, you remain in owning this right and other rights too, the right to vote. I don't think there's any particular market for that necessarily, but the point is, here we're trying to deal with a particular problem. We're not trying to change the structure of rights, but we recognize that it could be quite important to understand that the use right returns to the citizenship at the end of the period. The ownership right remains with the citizen. So from a legal perspective, we can take the view that the work permit is the citizen's property, but we give them the right to rent it out. And we ask the question, why should we be restricting that right? That itself is a restriction on freedom and arguably a deeper right that we impose without real justification. Also from the perspective of migrants and refugees, under this proposal, everybody would be treated equally under the law. Everybody in the working, all workers in the country would have to have a work permit. If you rented out your work permit, then that'll be indicated on your, for example, in the US, on your social security number. There'll be a flag that you rented out your work permit. Also, you can rent it back because you own it. You can rent it in, you can rent it out, you can rent it in. But there certainly could be implications. So I'll come back to some of those. But from the point of view of the migrants and refugees themselves, now they would no longer be second-class citizens. A lot of these issues about mistreatment could be dealt with. Discrimination against undocumented migrants or even documented migrants would be one benefit, removing that discrimination. Okay, that's the broad idea in outline. I'm going to give you a bit of an explanation of the theory. One first issue you've got to talk about is enforcement. And this is obviously important. Well, clearly the very existence of the problem implies that there is adequate enforcement in some sense, because if there was no enforcement, there would be no issue about restrictions on migration, because none of the restrictions would be enforceable. The issue would vanish. So clearly there must be in some sense adequate enforcement already. Another important point, which we elaborate in some detail in the paper, is that introducing a competitive market for work permits will make illegal migration less attractive. And in fact, you can design this scheme to eliminate illegal migration under certain parameters. Let's think about the simple example of that. Imagine you've got an upfront cost, C, per worker, right? This is from the point of view of an illegal migrant, right? Got to pay an upfront cost of C. That's, for example, that Nepalese worker to get into Malaysia paying 15,000 ringgit up front to a human trafficker. The legal option requires purchasing a work permit at price P. So you've got a choice between illegal and legal option. The legal option is buy the work permit yourself, right? And it's a market. You go onto the market, you put up your price, you're willing, you're able to put up that price, you get the work permit. There's also some probability, R here, in my notation, of an illegal immigrant being caught and deported, right? So a little bit of maths, we can get a very simple result that even with partial enforcement, if that probability, if P is the price of the work permit and C is the upfront cost, if that probability is less than 1 minus C over, sorry, if that probability is greater than 1 minus C over P, that's the critical, in that words, that's the critical level of enforcement, 1 minus C over P. Simple as that. As long as you get that probability above that, you will eliminate illegal migration. Now, we're not claiming you can do that, but it establishes some goal, if you like. Why is that the critical number? Well, it's pretty simple, really. If you think about the expected wage of the illegal migrant, well, they've got a wage, WL, so this is a person worker-specific wage, WL. There's that cost, C, of the of illegal migration, the payment to the trafficker or whoever, or the corrupt local official or whoever's got is taking this money. We also could have discrimination against the illegal migrants. That's this parameter delta. And there's a wage in the high wage country. So the worker, you can think of each worker having a WL and a WH, and here are the probabilities. So that's the expected wage. Now for a migrant to take the illegal route, then the expected wage has got to be greater than the wage in the low wage economy, obviously. They've got a gain, right? And that requires that their wage gap, so this again is the individual wage gap for that particular worker, is greater than this critical value, just solving this thing, right? for a migrant, so this is the condition. Under this condition, the migrant will take the illegal route. Yeah? What about the option for a work permit? Well, you've got a you can pay a price P. So the gain, the net gain is WH minus P. And here's that expected wage again. So now we require that this wage gap is greater than this critical number. And the key point is that those two things intersect. The set of WHWL combinations defined by this set and this set, they must intersect. And in fact, if that condition holds, if R is greater than 1 minus C over P, then all of those who chose the illegal route in the absence of a market, the illegal route in the absence of the market work permits will choose the legal route. And that's the reason why this is so important. What we're going to do now is essentially model the whole thing as if you can achieve this or something close to it. So we're going to assume there's a sufficient level of enforcement, right? Meaning that we're going to basically close off the illegal market and assume that it's largely vanished, and we're going to model the legal market. That's a big assumption. We'd like to develop a model that's a little bit more weakens that assumption, but we haven't got there yet. Okay, the wages. So here's a simple frictionless world. It's just a non-exist. There's no frictionless world here, of course, in the reality. But just to focus ideas. So we've got wages in the high wage country with a distribution function f of w on this support, right? And obviously these conditions hold. Okay. Then we've got a supply of workers. They're the number of people in the host country. Supply of work permits. Sorry. A number of people in the host country, in the destination country, who would be willing to sell their work permit. And we've got a demand, which is the number of people in the low-wage economy who'd be willing to buy a work permit. Equating the two, it's as simple as this. The equilibrium price is a point on the quantile function corresponding to the share of workers in the low-wage economy. Oh, it's super neat, but it also depends on a lot of simplifying assumptions. We've introduced quite a complex model of costs of migration, because all of these things are going to reduce that equilibrium price. And we can think of lots of costs here: foregone earnings, obviously, moving costs, out-of-pocket expenses, taxes on the purchase of the work permit, remittance levies, mysterious charges or whatever that you might incur. So we have a generalized version of that, where we think of two wage distributions. There's a wage distribution in the destination country for the workers in that country. And there's a wage distribution out of which migrants would draw, which is the distribution of wages again in the host country, but the wage distribution they face, net wage distribution, given all those costs. And of course, we assume that the net wage distribution is poorer, first order stochastic dominating actual distribution for wages in the host country. And then it's only a little bit more complex, the solution. It's now the market clears at the point on the quantile function of this hybrid distribution, which is simply a population-weighted mean of those two distributions, weighted by the relative sizes, NH, the number of people, share of the population in the high-wage economy, NL, the share of population, low-wage economy. So you just create this weighted average distribution, invert that to get the quantile function. That's how you get the equilibrium price. And we're going to implement all of this in our example for the US and Mexico. Obviously, an increase that we can also include in this a tax on the work permit, tau, and that's going to play an important role. That tax on the work permit is clearly an increase in that tax is going to be shared between the two sides of the market, as with any tax, and is going to increase the purchase price and decrease the selling price. It's also going to be a potentially important policy instrument for the host country. One way you can think about that tax is in terms of what I call the inverse problem, using the market for work permits to attain a desired minimum income in the host country. In other words, this is where the social protection idea is quite crystal clear, that in a sense we can think of every country as having some first best socially optimal distribution of income, and that has a floor, lower bound P bar. The problem is people are falling below P bar. Could be uninsured risks, missing markets, chronic poverty problems, information constraints, and so on. And you want to get everybody up to P bar. P bar is the lower bound of the first best distribution of income. Well, here's a way of doing it. simply solve this inverse problem and set a tax rate on work permits, which will achieve P-bar. P-bar in the distribution of earnings. That's important because all you can manipulate here is that distribution. The market for work permits now makes it possible for the host country to implement its socially optimal minimum earnings distribution. Okay. I'm in the wrong direction. You can also play with eligibility restrictions. Obviously, if many things here, you could be restricting what we're going to do in the empirical simulations is restrict the eligibility to in the US to Mexico, obvious place to start. I've been working in Malaysia a bit in recent times, and we could do a Malaysia-Indonesia version, for example. But whereas any reduction in NL is obviously going to increase the equilibrium price, and that reduction could either be achieved by restricting migrant eligibility or expanding eligibility to rent out the work permit amongst citizens of the host country. For example, you may, on a pilot basis, decide you're going to do this in some company town that's been decimated by the employer leaving town, and you say, okay, let's implement this within that context. Okay, what would it look like in auctioning? Misha and I have different ideas about Michael Auction. I have different ideas about how best to do this. He's fond of an eBay solution. I guess he's much younger than me, so maybe eBay is more something he's more comfortable with. But I'm more comfortable with simple double auction. We can think of each citizen submits an offer to rent out her work permit for duration D, cap D, and minimum accepted price, cap P. The buyer submits a desire. Makes a submission to the website saying I've got a desired duration of little d and a maximum price of little p, and you just sell the software, and this website just solves this double auction problem. And you're obviously with it's discrete, but we can do we can find a price that minimizes the excess demand as I've written here. That would be a very simple way of doing it. In practice, what will happen here? Each seller on his profile, social security number in the US, would have a flag whether that seller is whether the person has sold their work permit or not. With no reason at all why you wouldn't have a buyback option. So you sell your work permit, you rent out your work permit is better language. You rent out your work permit for a period, but you want to buy it back. Say you find, oh gosh, I can now get a really good job. I need my work permit back. Well, rent it back. You may introduce an insurance policy that guarantees you rent it back at the same price. There'll have to be a premium on that and have to be actuarially sound and so on, but that's not that wouldn't be too difficult. The buyer would receive a confirmation from the host country government about his purchase. That confirmation would not guarantee you get a visa, you've got security clearances and so on, but once you've got that confirmation, you make your petition for a visa. You can also imagine secondary markets developing for sellers and buyers, or legal support for sellers, for example, and insurance instruments. I already mentioned that possibility. An interesting comparison, when we think about social protection these days, well, the first thing we probably think about is a universal basic income. And one of the biggest things in social protection debates and discussion right now, the arguments for and against universal basic income. When we think about it, this can actually achieve pretty much everything you'd want out of a universal basic income, but with a number of ways that are more desirable. One of them is it's fully self-financing. This is entirely self-financing. You can even raise some revenue out of the policy. It's self-financing out of people in low-wage economies who would like to move to high-wage economies, financing the work permits that are sold by citizens in the high-wage economy. Unlike a UBI, it would be self-targeting. So, for example, Andrew Yang, who was running for to be Democratic nominee for president, was running, he pulled out, was proposing a UBI. And one of the arguments was to deal with people losing their jobs due to automation, robots, and so on. Oh, well, that's a very blunt way of dealing with that problem. Here we've got a very precise way of dealing with it. If you lose your job, then you rent out your work permit for a period to deal with that crisis in your life. It will be self-targeted automatically and directly to those who need help. And it could also be implemented in parallel with existing welfare programs. And, you know, I've got a worry there that we introduce this policy that displaces existing welfare programs, as was the case, for example, with Andrew Young's UBI. It wasn't actually a full UBI in the sense that it did displace existing welfare benefits, so the net gains were lower for poor people. But you'd want to be careful on that point, and we're not thinking of this as a replacement to existing welfare programs. Okay, summarizing all of this before I give you the example for US and Mexico, we see this as a way of reducing inequality, providing better social protection in host countries, lots of direct benefits. We're clearly going to reduce poverty and inequality in the host countries. There'll be non-pecuniary benefits as well. We can also think of it as a way of guaranteeing a minimum income. What we did in that application. Yes.
Can I just ask you a question that comes from one of the participants? How would the coordination about the duration of the rental period for the work permit work in practice? How would it be executed if the seller wants to buy back the permit before the duration agreed beforehand?
Yeah, there's absolutely no reason to coordinate them at all. The market is anonymous. You go into this website and you say, oh, I need to rent it out, and somebody rents a work permit. You don't. You're not actually in a bilateral trade with anybody, right? So there's no coordination problem of that sort. You go onto this website, sell your work permit. The website clears over some period of time, but it clears in time units. The total time of all the work permits rented sold equals the total time of all the rent permits bought over some time period. It doesn't have to clear every minute, obviously. That would be ridiculous. So you only clear over over some period of time. So there's actually no coordination problem at all. If you rent out your work permit and you decide to rent it back, the market can adjust.
Okay, just to tell you, you have 10 more minutes to go now.
Okay, thank you very much. That should be ample. Okay, so we wanted to get a feeling. I emphasize feeling for the size of this market. We have no idea because nobody's ever even talked about this. So we took two data sets for US and Mexico in 2018. Obviously, the CPS is the current population survey for the US. It's the March supplement is ideal. And the ANOE survey for Mexico in the same year. What we did is we want to estimate all the Mexican workers, how many could benefit from this by moving to the United States, given their skills and experience and occupation and so on. So what we do is we run the Mincerian regressions for earnings of US workers and plug in the characteristics of the Mexican workers in the ANOE website, in the ANOE survey, sorry, to figure out their expected wage in the United States. We also know their current wage in Mexico. So we've got that key parameter, their foregone income. And we do the whole thing at purchasing power parity. On the supply side, we're just counting, in a sense, the number of US workers who would be who earning less than the equilibrium price, which we have to figure out, obviously, the equilibrium price of the work permit. And that's a supply, which I've written here, supply of work permits. On the demand side, it's more complicated. We've got a whole bunch of parameters here. This is the number of buyers for work permits. In Mexico. So for all Mexican workers, they've got a number of things to deal with. We've got a remittances sent back home. We've got a tax on earnings in the US, and here's their predicted wage rate in the US. Here's the price of the work permit, obviously, which is in dodges. We're going to solve for that. We've got a tax on that, which is a policy parameter. And we've got direct costs of moving, which largely observable. This thing, which is just the extra cost above PPP of being in the US, because you know purchasing power parity rates have got some problems with comparison certain goods. Housing, for example, is going to be more expensive than probably predicted. And we've got the wage in Mexico. Let me just clear this up so I can see that myself. The foregone wage in Mexico. So some of these things data, some of these things are parameters, and we've got to consider various possibilities, for example, the tax on work permits. And then, of course, we find the equilibrium price solving this obvious problem. Here's a couple of simple supply and demand diagrams, but calibrated now to the data. So here we have the supply function for work permits. Here we have two demand functions, depending on different parameters. Here's just a summary. The paper gives many more simulation results. And here we've got the different policy parameters, the tax on work permits. We consider 0, 10, 40%. The extra cost of living in the US, different parameter values there. The remittance levy, how much you've got to send back to deal with things like keeping your house going and back in Mexico, all of that stuff, because you're a temporary migrant. You're not a permanent migrant. Then we simulate the whole thing, calculate all of the price of the work permit. So if you focus on this example, the equivalent price of the work permit is about $20,000. We've got about, this is the average earnings of sellers, and this is the expected earnings of buyers in the US. This is interesting. But basically, the net gain to the US economy is a bit under 6% of GDP per year. It's huge. We got just 28 million people engaged in this market. So this first calculation just tells us this would be huge. I mean, in a sense, that's just another way of saying the extent of the unexploited wage gaps, even between US and Mexico, are huge. The impact on poverty would be sizable, bring the US poverty rate to under 10% from over 12% now. Of course, it's going to eliminate earnings poverty, in some sense, because you achieve a minimum level of earnings income. But you've got people who are poor not because of low earnings, low income from other sources. So you don't eliminate overall income poverty, but you certainly bring it down quite a bit. The poverty impacts are illustrated here. These are the community distribution functions, but before and after the policy at the lower end, and just illustrating that point on the reduction we see for different parameter values. All this is elaborated in the paper, and it's downloadable. I want to conclude with a few comments on adapting the proposal, because there are a number of issues here. One of them is, what if a country like Malaysia has a manpower policy? It has a desired level of demand for workers in different skill occupation groups. You can adapt the policy to that problem to assure that you achieve your manpower policy by differentiating the tax. In other words, you think of this is the demand for category I of workers, say skill occupation group I. This is the pre-equilibrium price of the work permit as before, but you differentiate, you have an occupation specific tax rate needed to achieve your desired level of employment in that sector, right? And then the obvious adding up conditions. You can also adapt the policy to allow net inflow. So here you'd be saying, I don't want the market to clear. In a sense, I want to maintain a steady inflow. I want to maintain an excess demand for work permits. Again, Malaysia would be an example. Some developing countries, small populations, growing rapidly, economically growing rapidly. They've got an excess demand for labor and it's going to continue for a while. Well, you can easily adapt the policy to that. The price should be set below the equilibrium. You deliberately set it to create an excess demand. You can also adapt the policy to undocumented workers. Again, Malaysia is another example. The estimates are huge. In fact, somewhere between maybe 2 and 4 or 5 million migrants in Malaysia, and probably half of them undocumented. In a country of 32 million, we don't know the real population of Malaysia because of the extent of this undocumented workers. They don't obviously participate in surveys and censuses very willingly. And we can all obviously discount the work permit for undocumented workers to get them get them documented and formalized and being treated and living better. We can also adapt the policy to refugees. We've got over 30 million refugees worldwide, and it's increasing. This is the highest it's ever been, to our knowledge. All kinds of ways we could use this policy to get them jobs. I mean, one of the big problems for refugees is actually getting a job and getting a work permit. If you're in the OECD country, there are some legal conditions that should allow you a right to work, although it's not always the case. But many of the refugees, the vast majority, are not in OECD countries. There we've got a whole host of issues about how to get them work permits. And one example is the Syrian refugees in Turkey. 3.7 million Syrian refugees, 2 million working age, and only 1.5% of those of working age have got a work permit. So you've got huge sums of money being spent by the Turkish government and the European Union in looking after the Syrian refugees who would, many of them, I'm sure, be love to work. The early evidence is they'd be happy to do it. Some of them do illegally, but they'd love to work formally, and here's a way of getting them a work permit. And you divert some of that huge sum of money, the 40 plus billion that's being spent on looking after them, feeding them in refugee camps. Instead of doing that, you spend some of that money on buying work permits for them through this market mechanism. We think that would have a lot of appeal. Of course, it's entirely up to the war. The Syrian refugee, we can maintain their freedom to not buy their work permit, but we suspect there'd be a demand.
So Martin, refugee would,
yes.
Two more minutes.
Yep, 2 more minutes is all I need. I think I've explained how this would work in practice. So let's just conclude. I think about the implications of this both for high-wage economies and low-wage economies. High-wage economies, we've got a new form of social protection. Obviously, it put up huge, a lot of upward pressure on wages in the low-skilled sector. We'd see a reduction in wage inequality and income, a reduction in income poverty. We'd have a new form of social protection. We can generate tax revenue as you see fit. And we think the broad appeal of this form of social protection, anybody who gets any shock people facing risk are not just poor. Middle-income people in the United States face a lot of risk, downward risk. And this would be, give them social protection. It would also, we think, improve attitudes towards migrants in the host country. In a low-wage economy, of course, we've got this huge first-order welfare gain of those who could not otherwise get a work permit. Now, obviously, low-wage economies, the benefits are going to go to middle, high-skilled labor. We don't see this as a policy for dealing with poverty in low-wage economies. We've got plenty of other policies to deal with that. We see it as a way of trying to tap in to these, trying to assure that we can achieve, tap into those efficiency losses from restrictions on migration to the benefit of both workers in low-wage economies and high-wage economies. We'd also see a higher returns to education in low-wage economies. I'd like to just, very last slide, end with a few research issues going forward, because this is a new idea, and we fully recognize there's a lot of things to think about, where we're thinking about some of them, but we'd like others to help. We need more evidence on the frictions to migration. We tapped into everything we could find, but to narrow the range of parameter values, but more work on those frictions would be valuable. We'd also like to do a generic equilibrium model of the impact of the proposal. We've only modeled the market for work permits here, and we'd like to model the full labor market consequences, and that's a big job. We also like to learn more about attitudes to migration of native populations. And we think we could know more. And writing this paper exposed to us a lot of knowledge gaps, and this is one of them. Understanding better why native populations object to migrants and refugees. I think that would be interesting. Also, learning more about the costs of illegality. We think they're huge. I mean, Malaysia is doing field work in Northern Borneo, what used to be called Northern Borneo, Sabah, in going to some migrant communities, illegal migrant communities, the ones that I could go to safely. We've got a weird situation where people in these illegal migrant communities, that photo I had before was from one of them, built onto the sea because they can't get land. They're desperate to get formal papers. They can't get papers. The local residents are complaining all the time about them. Worries about crime, of course, I think they're exaggerated, but it's no great surprise if you can't get legal status, you resort to illegal means. But lots of issues there that should be could be researched. And there's lots of scope for maybe doing randomized control trials on access to work permits to see what happens. Okay, thank you very much.
All of us are more than welcome to jump in. So Dean Young was wanted to ask a question.
Yeah, thank you. Martin, thank you very much. Really, really like the paper. I'm really glad that you put this out in such a well, well fleshed out way. It occurs to me that your analysis, your sort of numerical analysis, can actually make the proposal seem even more attractive. If you modify the treatment of remittances, I think it's quite clear to me that you shouldn't be considering remittances to be a tax. If anything, you might give people a bonus for the fraction of their income that they send home as remittances. I mean, remittances are, I think for the most part, we should think about them as voluntary uses of funds. So we shouldn't, think about them as a tax. Some portion of remittances may be repayment of migration costs. And so that would be a little bit different, but you're already counting migration costs elsewhere in your calculation. So that would be double counting. Think about remittances, giving some bonus to remittances, the share of income that's earned as remittances, because of differences in purchasing power in the home country versus the U.S. So dollars sent home actually go farther in terms of, raising utility than dollars spent in the U.S.
Yeah, I suggest we take a round of questions because probably you would dedicate too much time to each response individually. So I think it's better if you pick a round of questions and then you answer the ones you like the most or you dislike the less, or at least the one you can answer.
Okay.
So I will have two questions, but maybe we give other people the right to speak first.
Go on, Ilan.
Okay, so my two questions relate to theory. So in your motivation, you insisted on the kind of cultural externality, the cultural backlash. And I was wondering how this externality is taken into account. I can see there is a market, but this market itself is not accounting for all the migration externalities, it seems to me, or maybe I misunderstood something. And then the other motivation was the elimination of the illegal migration. And so I understand that in your simple model where there is an homogeneous cost, there is a simple condition, then it was very quick and complex on the distributions of wages, which somehow account for heterogeneity, somehow implicitly in the cost of migration. But I was wondering in terms of selection, what this will do. If you assume heterogeneity, some people with high cost, some people with low cost, this is the critique that was done to Becker, right? That only high-profile prostitutes and criminals would pay a very high price for visas. So does this critique apply here if you assume heterogeneity in the cost? And then my last question was about the tax. I was wondering whether you allow for a negative tax, meaning the subsidy, because your motivation was that maybe some people don't take enough social protection and would better, use the market. We would need more people to use the market than we do. So in this case, we need a subsidy. But if it's a subsidy, then you must ask whether this is the first best use of public funds for social protection, or whether some alternative uses could be better to achieve social protection.
Okay. Do you want to collect any more questions?
I would like just to ask one short question. So you're comparing your proposal with a universal basic income. I thought that another natural comparison would be with a point-based system that screens immigrants, because you could think of this temporary migration as a way to enter the destination country and possibly reveal your productivity and get employers interested in keeping you at destination for a long time after this temporary scheme has expired.
Yeah.
There was also Luigi wanted to ask a question. Luigi, do you want to unmute your microphone?
Yes. Hi, I'm Luigi. Thanks a lot for the very nice talk. Every super quick question about attitudes toward migrants that you mentioned toward the end. So I was wondering what would be the effect of such a policy on such attitudes. And on the one hand, I tend to think that, you know, the policy could look little, as we know that, I mean, research has shown that this negative attitude toward migrants are mainly driven by non-economic aspect, even in situations where migration has a positive effect overall. On the other hand, I mean, this policy could also make benefits from migration kind of more visible for the general population, more salient in a way, because there is a direct yeah. transfer, direct payment. So I was curious to know what's your stand about this.
Okay. should I deal with these questions, or you want to?
Yeah.
Okay. So thank you very much. All good questions, and all actually things we've thought about in different ways. Maybe one exception, but Dean Yang. We agonize over this too, but we think there is a. Maybe we didn't frame it quite the best way, but we think there is a remittance levy in a sense that if you're going to go to a high-wage economy, you're going to have to pay your dues, and for good reasons. You know, you've got to keep the home back. You're a temporary migrant. You've got to, in a sense, keep your place back home. You've got to probably maintain your family, a bunch of things that we think of as costs. But of course, we can also we play with that number and drive it down to zero as one option, if you like, and see what happens. And we do that, and I think we do that in the published version of public version of the paper. And the point you raise about differences in purchasing power parity, we discuss that a bit, but that's well taken. Hillel, we're not claiming it deals with all the migration externalities. I should have made this clearer. We're only putting something on the table that would, in a sense, what we're hoping something big on the table that would change the balance of perceptions about migrants in the host country. Right, as Luigi mentioned at the end there. That's the important thing. You're not going to internalize all the externalities. You can go some way. Obviously, the tax could be used to for that purpose a bit, but we're trying to. We see it as a political economy instrument, you know, to try to make migrants more popular. And here's a big thing that would be really clearly tied to migrants. So it gives them something, gives people in the host country something they don't have, which is could be, as we've argued, extremely valuable. But we don't for a moment imagine that there won't be other externalities, other costs that we don't internalize. We can't eliminate all of those problems. All we want to do is kind of change the balance in a way that is more favorable to making migrants more popular in host countries. The selection point is well taken. We haven't thought, this is one thing we never thought about, a negative tax. And, you know, I guess one reason would be then we really would have to worry about what the alternative uses of the funds would be, providing subsidies. I have to think about that. Simone's point on the comparison to a points-based system. I guess you could think of a points-based system as a bit like what I was referring to at the end, where you have a desired portfolio of entry into the host country according to, say, certain occupations. I mean, my country, Australia, has a point system where Australia has a kind of, you can think of it as like that manpower policy. They have a desire, they need doctors or whatever it is. And they build that into the point system, or you would integrate that into the work permit. I hadn't thought about that way, but I think you could do that. I agree with Luigi's comments on attitudes to migrants. Was as part of the reason we're assuming that this would be a big popular thing in host countries. It doesn't have to. The policy you implement to make it migrants more popular in host countries doesn't have to deal with all of the concerns, a bit like the point on externalities. It doesn't have to deal with all of the concerns, obviously, it can't. There's also, we're not so sure on this point about how much is economic or non-economic. It seems to us reading the literature that a lot of what people, a lot of the cultural backlash is tied in some sense to the economic consequences or perceived economic consequences. And some is not, clearly, as I said. I mean, there's some fundamental racism here that is undeniable. We can chip away at that. And I think this policy would help. But I'm not pretending that it would eliminate the problem. Okay, other questions out there?
There are questions by Souline, Bastien, Farid, Gilles, Yann. You can unmute and start talking.
Thanks. Yeah, I have one question. Jan Stuhler here from UC3M. I have one question regarding the implications of this policy over the business cycle. So one example was that workers who become unemployed, they might want to rent out their work permit. But if that happens on an aggregate scale, that means more people want to rent out the work permit in exactly the time when labor demand is weak, and more workers might arrive in exactly those times, right? So.
Yeah, yeah. No, fair comment. I haven't thought about that, but that's a good question.
This is Bastien from Leiser in Luxembourg. So you mentioned general equilibrium effects, and I was possibly worried about the fact that this policy would change the monopsony power of employers on the market. If you assume that the possibility that migrants come in are probably less organized or less unionized. And the other concern would be about the appeal of informal or illegal work in the host country for people having sold their work permit.
Yeah.
Can we just take a couple of more questions? Yep.
Maybe Farid, I have maybe one question on the or two questions. One related to the government: could the government dry the market to prevent entry? Because the market is anonymous, and after all, it could prevent entry regarding the preference of the society. And the second one is just like: could we see just like as in trade, big intermediaries buying and selling baskets of different lengths of permits so that the price will not reflect after all the value of the permit, but the value plus some kinds of markup.
Mm-hmm. What was your first question on preventing entry?
The first question is about the government. Could the government buy just like or dry the market just like to prevent entry of refugees in its country?
Okay. Do you want to collect other questions? You said there was
Is someone else who wants to speak among the people that have been allowed?
Can I jump in real quick? Here's Sabine. Thank you for the presentation. I have a question regarding the premise of this. So I wonder if the binding constraints is really the availability of work permits. For instance, we've seen a liberalization in the ability of immigrants to come to Germany and look for jobs here. They're allowed to come when they can prove that they have sufficient funds and they can look for a job for several months and then start working. So basically, de facto, this sort of ability to come in and look for a job and then sort of pay a tax to the government instead of paying the owner of the work permit already exists, and it doesn't seem to move the numbers much. So we think about language barriers, demand for specific types of labor as the binding constraints more than the work permit itself. And then when it comes to the political economy of this, I wonder whether you are creating a private market for a political problem. So in principle, 49% of the working population could just decide, or the voting population could just decide to increase the number of migrants in the economy and in society, while there's no political consensus for this. And I'm not sure whether this will really attenuate the skepticism towards migration or actually perpetuate that.
So the last two questions, Jill and Joan.
Hello.
Joan, go on. Yep.
Yeah. So thanks for the talk. So I was wondering about you mentioned general equilibriums as a possible extension here. So I was wondering about that because so the way in which one thinks of open borders in the general equilibrium world is that at the end of the day, in a very simple model, you know, like factors equalize, wages maybe end up being equal or equal to some factor of productivity. But in this world, you know, like the equalization happens to wage plus price, right? And you can have an equilibrium in which, you know, many workers from low productivity countries move to high productivity countries, but workers from high productivity countries don't work and just get the money from the permit. So would that be less efficient than the open borders normal thing?
Okay. Was there another one? Another question?
Oh, you? No, it's not intervening. So you can reply, Martin.
Okay. Again, all good questions. Thank you very much. I can't answer all of them this quickly, but let me just make a few points. You know, the alternative to, with the Bastian, your comments on the genetic effects and the concern about monopsony power. General effects, we agree, and that's something we'd like to look at. You know, I can't see, it doesn't seem to me very likely that migrant workers would, see, in this policy, all workers are treated the same way, and there'll be a transition period. So in a sense, it would undermine the monopsony power of the way that migrant workers are treated, either because they're illegal or because of their limited status or the recognition that they're migrant workers. And in some sense, what we're trying to do is create a situation where everybody in the labor market is treated the same way. And we think that that would undermine a lot of these concerns about the way that migrants are treated, being less unionized and so on. So we're kind of arguing and go the opposite direction. And I can't really see an argument that would suggest otherwise. Whether how much it goes in that direction is another issue, and it could be a transitional problem, of course, but there could be problems in the transition period. But we think in the kind of equilibrium of this thing, you'd essentially eliminate the distinction. So migrant workers would pay the same taxes, get the same services, they'd do everything, they'd be treated exactly the same way as citizen workers. Farid, I didn't understand why the government implements this policy. So why would the government now want to prevent entry? I don't understand this. It is a government policy. The government creates this market. It regulates this market. You can run it as a semi-autonomous thing. Maybe an agency is doing it through and regulating the website, but the government is totally regulated, totally in charge here. So I'm not sure why it would do that. We would be opposed. I think we talk about this briefly in the paper, but we would be opposed, I think, to intermediaries or firms buying up lots of work permits. Or we think it makes a lot more sense to think of it as individuals going into this market. And we could readily imagine a lot of problems otherwise. I didn't quite understand this. Maybe Germany is different to everywhere else, work permits are a binding constraint on getting a job legally in every host country. That's pretty clear. I doubt if Germany would be different, but maybe there are other aspects of the problem of migrant workers that would be fully recognized. As I said, there's no reason at all why a lot of these issues on imbalances in particular sectors and desire for particular to accommodate particular skill mixes couldn't be incorporated into the policy through the design of the taxes, the tax schedule, or work permits conditional on your sector. It's not a private market, it's a public market. It is intended to deal with a political economy problem. Okay, Juan's point, as I understand your point, if we can do open borders, great, then the whole problem goes away. Everything we're talking about is precisely because you can't do open borders. And in fact, we're moving away from open borders. So we're trying to find another way of tapping into the inefficiency of the closed borders, which is socially beneficial. So that's the point. I mean, I think saying that open borders will be better, no argument about that. I'm fully in favor of open borders. I think there'd be huge transitional issues and you'd have to manage it in a very careful way. But that's not in anybody's radar screen. If you think this policy is ambitious, that's just out there. Okay, thank you very much.
I just want to thank you for the lively and very interesting discussion. And so I think it was a good one. And we hope to have many more in the coming weeks.
Okay, good. Thank you all.
I was just thanking Martin. That was an excellent start for our seminar series. These are some of the next speakers. I was just referring to May 13, Mushfiq Mubarak, simply because Martin referred to the paper that he will be presenting on the Bangladesh to Malaysia lottery. But there are many more: Michelle Bain, Yanai Spitzer, Giovanni Peri, Esther Arenas Arroyo, Joan Lul, who intervened today, and other speakers have already conferred, but not fix a date, Anna Maria Maida from Georgetown, as Martin, and Flo Gubert from Dial. So you can find all the information online. You can send me an email if you want to be added to the mailing list so that you can receive all the information. And thanks again to Martin and to all the other organizers who contributed to set these up.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Simone.
Bye.